There are as many downsides to digital technologies as there are upsides to it. That's because a technology is always neutral. It's just a tool. A hammer can be very useful to build a house that protects you, but it can also be abused to do a lot of harm. You can destroy human life with it. So is it there to protect you? Is it there to harm you? Well, it's just the hammer. And digital technology is also just a tool. And we could go through the entire list of upsides and downsides and what it can do to society. Can it foster freedom? Can it take away freedom? And the attention is a very good place to start. Is this technology increasing our attention or catering to our attention, showing us what we actually want to pay attention to, or is it distracting us? 7 out of 10 parents say that this technology is distracting their teens while they're trying to have a conversation with them in that moment. Now, at the same time, 50% of teenagers say the same about their parents, that their parents are distracted while they are trying to have, with their mobile phones, while they are trying to have a conversation with them. So, you know, this phenomenon has become pretty far. Chris Nodder, a user interface programmer, actually wrote a book that's called Evil by Design. It's a book about the design of these technologies, of persuasive technologies and interface online designs. And he actually structured this entire book according to the 7 capital sins: pride, sloth, gluttony, anger, envy, lust, and greed. So it seems a little bit, or it could be at least be represented, that these technologies are evil by design. And if you want to talk what these technologies can do, well, they can certainly bring out the worst in us. So how did it get so far that we now understand the downsides of this technology? It actually is more like a historical accident, because the ambition of some of these downsides was at the beginning to provide information for free and this paradigm has been around before digital technology, for example, in television. So television also provides information to people for free by selling ads, basically. And then already in the 70s, there was a lot of talk about, well, how does it actually work that this is for free television content? Well, it's for free because you are basically the product. And that's something communication scholars have pointed out in the 70s about television already. You are the product of TV. Well, who is the client? The client is the advertiser that buys ads. And the provider is the TV station. And who is the product that's sold? Well, that's you. Your attention is the product that's sold by the TV station to the other part that buys the commercials. And the social media world especially has picked up on it. Now, it's not like they went all in the basement, you know, Mark Zuckerberg and Jeff Bezos and Larry Page, and they were sitting in the basement and together with the Joker and the Penguin, drinking whiskey, smoking cigars, and thinking about how they could dominate the world and get the evil out. No. Basically, they were just trying to see, like, okay, so how can we make a model out of here that we adopt the premises as well to provide information for free? And these services are for free. Google Maps is for free. Your Messenger is for free. Your message service is for free. Your information service are for free. And they did that basically by selling ads. So again, just like in the 70s, who's the product? You are the product here that speaks. So actually, it became a little bit more sophisticated because they had so much information about you, so much big data, digital footprint, that they were not only selling the time that you pay attention to something, they were actually to predict your behavioral change. So by knowing you well, and in contrast to television, selling you custom-made ads, they were also able to predict that with that they could change your behavior, that you, for example, would click on something. So what they would actually sell to their clients, which are the guys who buy ads, who buy the commercials, is they would sell your predictable behavioral change. So what they would sell is not actually you, what they would sell is the result of brainwashing you. And they were able to predict, they are able to predict this 80, 90% accuracy, right? So that's why this became a very successful business model. And these companies started to dominate the commercial advertising market. Now, it wasn't by bad intent. They're just trying to actually see, well, how could they change your behavior? How could they make you click on the next thing? And they also, there are not a lot of psychologists in Silicon Valley that see, like, how can we manipulate your behavior? No, they just do this by blind A-B testing. It's kind of like a blind evolutionary algorithm mutation. They show you two mutations, two different aspects of one, for example, a headline, a green and a red headline. Then selection, they show that to thousands, millions of people, and they see, do people or which kind of people click on what headline more? Then they have your big data footprint, match that up, and then retention. Mutation, selection, retention. So that's like blind evolutionary tinkering. And with that, they figure out that, well, version B works better than version A. That's why it's called A-B testing. Now, that quickly leads to downsides. For example, just to give you one idea of how that leads to downsides, is you might pay attention to something, same as you might pay attention to a car accident on the road. Well, you cannot not pay attention to that, because evolutionary-wise, you have been programmed to pay attention to these kind of, for example, things that could potentially be dangerous for you. A car accident that happened to somebody else. Now, is that really what you want to pay attention to? Now, the algorithm that selects the A or the B version doesn't know. It just realizes, whoa, everybody is staring at a car accident. So we should show people car accidents all day long, right? Because basically, the result of the algorithm is, well, that's how they can actually get your attention. And by having your attention like this in the attention economy, then they can change your behavior, get you to, and that's the product that they're selling. They're selling the result of influencing you. Now, I can really have your attention and actually change your behavior once I have you addicted. Because the idea of addiction is that you cannot not pay attention. You need to pay attention to it. You crave it. I created a craving in you. I created a need for you to pay attention to this and to do basically what this machinery wants you to do. You're addicted. You're a slave to it. And then during the early 2010s, there were a few books coming out here in Northern California. They've been bestsellers in Silicon Valley, like The Webs of Influence and Hooked, which basically are recipes to get you addicted. And a lot of technology providers, technology companies then basically played this playbook, a lot of startups, because once they have your attention to that degree, they can surely manipulate you. And that's the product that you're selling in the attention economy. Now, some of these authors, for example, Nir Eyal, who wrote the famous book Hooked, which is a bestseller, five years later, and some heartfelt conversations with his daughter later, he realized, whoa, we're doing some things here that I'm not sure if they're okay. So he wrote another follow-up book called Indistractable. He basically then explained how after they get you hooked, now how you can get yourself indistractable from all the distractions. Well, anyways, it's a full-time job to keep up with these suggestions.